Good evening, everyone. I would like to welcome you to North Shore Community College's 38th Forum on Tolerance. Our topic, as Dr. Carlson mentioned, is that of dementia. Since 1996, our forums have been intended to teach tolerance, embrace inclusion and diversity, and provide a forum for our community of learners to discuss topics that impact our lives and shape our shared experiences. Before getting started with tonight's conversation, I would first like to thank Dr. Lori Carlson and all of the members of the Forum on Tolerance Committee for their leadership and efforts to host this critical dialogue. Would all of you please stand to be recognized that are involved in the forum? Thank you, guys. Today in the United States, we know that an estimated 5.5 million people are living with Alzheimer's disease. Worldwide, an estimated 44 million have been afflicted with dementia. Chances are many of you know someone, a parent, a grandparent, a spouse, a sibling, a friend, a neighbor, or even yourself, who may be suffering with this ailment. Like many chronic illnesses, diseases like dementia impact the person who's afflicted, as well as their families and caretakers. Ensuring humane care and enhancing their quality of life are at the forefront of providing quality care for those afflicted with dementia and for their support network. So without further ado, I'm very pleased to introduce tonight's guest speaker, Alice Bonner, our Massachusetts Secretary of Elder Affairs. In addition to her work in Elder Affairs, Dr. Bonner also serves as an associate professor at Northeastern University. And prior to joining Elder Affairs, she served as the director of the Division of Nursing Home Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services. We are thrilled to have her here to share her wealth of knowledge and her passion for this important topic. Dr. Bonner?
I love being in a gymnasium. I wish I could take a jump shot, but I am terrible at basketball. So thank you very much for inviting me and for having me here this evening. And you know, this is just a topic that I know resonates with everyone who has chosen to come here this evening. And for me, it's one of the things that I have in common with my boss, Governor Baker, because Governor Baker's mother had Alzheimer's disease for about 10 years. She died last year, and he's been very vocal, speaking about his family, speaking about his mother, speaking about his father and the caregiving that the whole family has done. So I wanted to talk with you a little bit about my mother. She's 87 years old, and she's had dementia for probably about 7 or 8 years. And she has a very busy life, so I'll tell you her schedule for the week. And she has moderate dementia, so if she were standing here and speaking with you, you wouldn't be able to understand very much because she has almost no words left in her communication. She says, we have to come for the thing that is coming, and it's gonna come, and that's where we'll come. That's how she talks. So you can't understand her, and you have to really know her to know what she's talking about. Nevertheless, on Mondays and Thursdays, she has a two-hour rehearsal for a singing and dancing group she's in called Young at Heart. You may have heard them. They're a group in Massachusetts in the western part of the state that all of the people in the group are over age 70. They're phenomenal. If you ever get a chance to just, you know, go online and look at some of their videos. But anyway, she's been a dancer her whole life. And so she still sings and she still dances. So that's Mondays and Thursdays. On Thursdays at 1:30, she also takes tap dancing lessons, which she's trying to get private lessons because she doesn't think the other people in the group are very good. And being a professional dancer, she knows something about it. And I told her she could afford private lessons, but then she goes. And then on Wednesdays, she just moved into an assisted living and they have a chorus. So now she sings with that group. And on Fridays, she and her companion pick up day-old bread and other food at the Big Y, and the companion drives them to the survival center, which is for homeless families, and my mother does volunteering. And that is, you know, because that's who she's always been. My mother has volunteered or done something in her community her entire life. And so one of the important things that you're going to hear about this evening in this program, and that's so critical to inclusivity in communities when it comes to individuals living with dementia, is that we have to see the person. We have to see them as, I am a person who happens to be living with dementia. But who my mother really is she's a dancer, she's a singer, she's a volunteer, she's a member of her community, and it's so critical. So for a long time, she just moved into assisted living very recently. For many years, she was living by herself in a condo because my father died about 12 years ago. And, you know, we would keep watching. Every week I would go out, and the big deal was driving, right? So she has, you know, she's driving pretty well for a while, but then she started to be a little bit less safe, and I would always drive with her every week so I could assess this. It finally got to the point where she clearly was not going to be safe driving. So, again, for anybody in this audience who has done this, one of the hardest things you will ever have to do is say to a parent that, you know, they're no longer safe to drive. And so I actually took her for a driving test. And the occupational therapist, who was wonderful and very, very skilled. I mean, my mother, by the end, failed every one of these 10 points on this 10-point test. You know, the physical part, the cognitive part, understanding the road signs and everything. But it was still, it was just really gut-wrenching to have to take her keys away. And I was so angry that I was in a position to make her so unhappy as her caregiver. So it's a really challenging thing. I was so fortunate that this occupational therapist and this program were so good and so skilled. And in no way did they make my mother feel like she had failed a test. I mean, she was just so good at explaining things. So that was another example of sort of inclusivity. And then getting a companion who then was going to drive my mother to all these activities so she didn't have to lose that connection with her community. And she could still go into town when she can't count money anymore. So, you know, she'll take out a big roll of, you know, $20 bills, and, you know, she has no idea how to exchange money at a store or a restaurant. So her companion, fortunately, can do that. And they go to places in her town where people are compassionate and understanding and don't rush her, and they start to get to know her. So what I do is I always go back every weekend to the same places, the same stores where I know the storekeepers. She has a wonderful local bank, and the bankers are really good with her because she just goes up to the teller and she says, I need three. You know, I need three. And she'd get very, you know, annoyed if they can't figure it out. But they know her, so they're able to really be inclusive, be tolerant. And so we're building these dementia-friendly communities, and you're so fortunate. And Paul Crowley's here with his team from GLIS, and I've just been hearing wonderful work. I got a button from them about dementia-friendly Saugus and dementia-friendly Lynn, which is the next city that's going to be coming on board. And dementia-friendly communities do what I've been so fortunate to have in my mother's community in Northampton. We develop and teach people about dementia, about what it means to be a caregiver and to be helping someone with dementia, so that everyone in the community, the banks, the hairdressers, the restaurants, the hotels, the shopkeepers, and the municipal leaders, the mayor, and the police and the EMTs, everyone could come together and understand what it means to be living with dementia and can learn that tolerance and that inclusivity. So my mother was safe at home for a very long time. She never wandered. She never left her home when she was by herself until one day she ran out of bananas. And she eats a banana every morning. So this was like a crisis in her mind. So she walked on a very bitterly cold day, about 2.5 miles. She found her way to the store where she buys bananas. And when she got there, The storekeeper recognized that I wasn't there, her companion wasn't there, and, you know, my mother was sort of going around the store, couldn't find the bananas, so the storekeeper called 911 because there's not really a whole lot else that you can do. And so when the EMTs showed up and the public safety folks showed up, they brought my mother back to her house and called me, which I was very grateful because they really wanted to take her to the emergency room. And there was just nothing wrong with her except for the whole banana thing. So, you know, she would have gone to the emergency room doctor and said, I, you know, ran out of bananas. So we can do better in communities by working with public safety, working with EMTs, working with local police. Many of you know that the Alzheimer's Association and other groups, you know, like GLIS, will have systems, either a GPS system, some sort of a tracking system for someone who repeatedly wanders. Again, I'm very fortunate. My mother, that was the only time that that happened, and now she's in assisted living, so she's more monitored, but she could still wander away, and she's, you know, because she's a dancer, she can walk pretty fast, pretty far. So, you know, having some sort of GPS system or alert system so that a caregiver could be informed when someone wanders off is really important. But I wanted to just get back to this notion of personhood again, because it's part of what we teach in Dementia Friendly Massachusetts. And Dementia Friendly Massachusetts is a collaborative effort of elder affairs, of our team, of the Alzheimer's Association, the Councils on Aging, the ASAPs throughout the state, Leading Age, and a number of other partners, and AARP and others. And community by community, we are ensuring that Massachusetts can become a dementia-friendly state, because any community can do this. This work started in Minnesota, where there was something called Act on Alzheimer's, and they developed a whole toolkit so that if you were a community leader, if you're a selectman, or if you're a mayor, you can bring this to your community. We're doing this in my hometown, which is Westboro, and there's all of the materials that you need to go around to the local shopkeepers and the public safety folks and to educate the superintendent of schools and everyone, you know, at the civic club. It's all there. You don't have to invent anything. You can just download these materials, make copies of them, and so in Westboro, I go around and I've got a couple of local businesses. I go to the business, I bring the welcome letter, and I say, we're doing some work with our town around becoming dementia friendly. I'm wondering if you would speak to me a little bit. And we have a little survey that we ask people about in terms of, you know, what sort of strengths they bring and what needs they have. And we're doing this all over the state. So we started out with about 12 communities that were doing this, and now we're up to, I don't know, well over 40 communities. And it's growing all the time, especially the memory cafes. So again, go see the people at GLIS. They are talking about their memory cafes, but memory cafes, we have, I think, over 80 or 90 now in the state. So this is where caregivers, people like myself and my mom, could go together, and we would, you know, we would do activities, and I would get some respite, and there'd be other caregivers there and other individuals who are living with dementia who my mom could talk with. It's very, very collaborative. So this notion of what we're doing here and turning communities into not only inclusive, tolerant communities, but also places where people can be joyful and can thrive, even when they're living with dementia, is the subject of, this came across my email just this morning, a Kaiser Health News article about living with Alzheimer's and dementia and how we've really gotten an appreciation from a lot of caregivers and people who have been diagnosed who are speaking out, that it's not this sort of death sentence. It's not this downward trajectory and, you know, this sort of miserable existence, that only about 25% of people with dementia report having a low quality of life. People can still relate to their grandchildren. They can still enjoy their activities. I will tell you, my mother is the most joyful person, and it's partly because she's always been like that, but when I walk in the door, I've only been gone a week, I go there every week, she just says, how did you get here. Oh my God, it's like I've been gone for years. But she's so glad to see me. It's just great. And you know, in town, if she sees a little baby in a stroller, she loves children, she'll bend down, she'll, you know, talk to the kids, and she's just very, very affectionate. So, and she's happy. She's genuinely happy. I think sometimes she's lonely. There's no question. But it's something to consider. And again, this article did a really nice job of talking with experts and talking with individuals who could say, there are good things that can still happen to me in my life. And there's positive things that can happen with my family and my caregivers as well. So I know that I'm fortunate that, you know, I have the resources, my mother has the resources that we can pay a companion and that she can live in assisted living. We're very, very fortunate. Not everyone is so fortunate, but together we can come to a place where our communities throughout the Commonwealth are really supportive and inclusive and tolerant of people with living with dementia and their caregivers, and where we're doing a better job to support caregivers. And that's our goal, is that, you know, the Commonwealth will look different a year from now, 2 years from now, 5 years from now, because we'll continue to really all work together on all of these initiatives. So I know there's lots of people in this audience, probably most people in this audience, who are working on either a memory cafe or the Council on Aging or dementia-friendly Lynn Saugus, wherever you're from. And I want to thank you for that, because it's not something we could do by ourselves at Elder Affairs. We need all of you to be great ambassadors for inclusivity and tolerance around dementia. So I thank you for coming here this evening and inviting me, and I'll look forward to hearing more on the program. So thanks so much.
What bureaucratic talk did you want to hear about?
It's just so refreshing to hear. I mean, you know what you do and so on. And it's so refreshing to hear that you see that all through the lens of what's happening in your own family life. It's great.
Thank you.
I didn't mention too much about multicultural communities and disadvantaged communities, but again, I would say that I am well aware that there's many people who are struggling to be a caregiver who have to quit their job, use their kids' college fund, use their retirement fund, just because they don't want to put someone they love in a nursing home, and they really struggle with that. And there's a lot of costs that go along with caregiving as well. Not everything is covered by, you know, Medicare, Medicaid, and so we need to think about the cultural aspects of dementia also in all different kinds of communities where people are at all different income levels as well. So I'm glad I don't sound like a bureaucrat after 30 years. Yes?
You mentioned the governor at the beginning of your speech, and I listened to his State of the State address, where he really paid honor and respect to his own parents, and he said he was going to establish some kind of committee on aging.
Yeah.
So I'd like to hear a little bit more about that, if he's done that.
Okay, good. If I would only read my own notes, I actually was going to start with that, but then I got off on a tangent. So thank you for mentioning that. Last week, the governor did make good on his promise that he said in the State of the Commonwealth to establish a council to address aging in Massachusetts. And the goal is to make Massachusetts the best place to grow older and the most livable state for people at any age. Because if we make communities age-friendly, if we make communities, where there are complete streets and people can walk without needing to get in the car, and we have affordable housing, and we have health care that's accessible, and civic opportunities and job opportunities, then it's a good community for everybody at any age. They did some age-friendly work in Brookline, and one of the things that the committee came up with was a
list of all of the public places that let you use the bathroom if you needed to, use the restroom, and they thought they were doing it for older adults who might need to use a restroom when they're out, and it turned out it was mothers with little kids who were the big beneficiaries and thought it was the greatest thing. So, you know, if we do things that make sense for older adults, it's going to be generally things that make sense for everybody. I know there's some neat things like in Leominster, I think, there's a playground that is designed for people with dementia, or for part of the year they design it, and it's all purple and kind of a neat idea. So anyway, the governor established in his executive order a council of individuals who were selected not because they necessarily have expertise in aging, but because they have, they're thoughtful and interested in all of us and our aging. And so there's people from the technology sector, there's people from the business sector. It's co-chaired by Secretary Mary Lou Sutters, HHS Secretary, and Eileen Connors, who is a philanthropist and a social worker. So we have two social workers with expertise in geriatrics. We are also working very closely with the co-chairs. So we think it's going to be a really exciting opportunity to address aging, not just from aging services perspective, which is what we do, but really across all secretariats, transportation, housing. We talk about aging in every policy. So aging in every policy means, you know, education, workforce, all the secretariats, and the secretariats are also represented. So first meeting, May or June, and much more to come on that. And we will be asking for stakeholder input. So if you have ideas on the first place you would go to improve the experience of aging, I mean, essentially the question is, if I said to you, what's it like to get older here in Lynn? You know, what would you say? And, you know, that's what we want to ask people in every community. So thank you for the question. All set?
Okay.
Thank you.
So we have several speakers here this evening, and our next speaker has her master's degree in psychology with a concentration on alternative methods with Alzheimer dementia. Now, she has been really passionately crusading all over New England as she teaches what she calls her hippie philosophy to caregivers, helping them to find the joy to take care of themselves and to embrace the journey. Tonight, we are certainly privileged that she will share a small portion of her lecture with us. Her lecture is based on the book that she is currently finishing up called Embracing the Journey, Knowing Your Inner Hippie. We welcome Phyllis DeLaricheliere.
Hello, how are you? Good, welcome. So yes, my name is Phyllis DeLaricheliere. I'm very proud of him. He had the unfortunate task of having to say my last name. And I am on this crusade, this mission, to kind of share with you a different perspective on how to approach and how to look at those with dementia. Anybody here actually caring for someone with dementia or Alzheimer's at this time? Great, thank you for sharing. So let's talk a little bit about it. You know you have two brains, right? It's always a good excuse when you say one's on vacation, you've got the other one, but you do have two brains. And those two brains I have in my thesis kind of given personalities to, I've kind of given names to, and it will help us as we go forward in this lecture. The first part is your left brain. Now, your left brain I refer to as the judge. The left brain is your logical side. It's where you think. It's where you process good, bad, nice, ugly. It's your drama queen, not that we have that, lives there. It's also the victim. Our martyrs live on our left side of our brain. 80% of us lead with our left brain. We all are wired to be creative from birth, but as we get older and we have education and life experiences, we tend to lead with our logical side, our left brain. What I say is when you are diagnosed with dementia, as it progresses, your judge retires. Does that make sense? The judge retires, and I think you'll know what I mean. So I would like to do a little experiment, if you wouldn't mind. Could I have you all just stand up for a moment? Very nice, thank you. And make sure that you have a little bit of room next to you. Make sure the person next to you isn't crowding your personal space, because we're going to learn how to do the hula. And I'm going to have a few of you come up, and I, as always, the tall ones I grab, and I'm going to have a few of you come up just to be demonstrators in the front. So make sure that you have enough space to, and then I'll bring some of you up. Now, how many of you are already going, oh my God, please don't pick me? All right, how many of you are looking at each other going, she's crazy, and I want to sit down now? Congratulations, that's your judge. Have a seat. So the judge in you is going, this is not logical. Master's in psychology, where'd she get it? Out of a Cracker Jack box? This is not an experiment. I feel like an idiot, right? That's our judge. And a few of you are going, I was ready to go. He was ready to go. He was coming around. He was going to be my volunteer, right? That's because that's your hippie side. The right side of your brain, and that's you, my friend, the right side of your brain, I refer to as your hippie. I don't believe, sorry, that it is a long goodbye. I don't believe that you're gone. We're losing them when they have dementia. I just believe it's a chance to fall in love with your loved one all over again, because we're being introduced to the right side of our brains that most of us have not used in a very long time. How many of us have met that person that just thinks the world is fabulous and the world is full of color and joy? We call them eccentric. They are right brain led for the most part. It doesn't mean they're not logical, but they see life through their right brain first. 20% of us. But we're all from the beginning wired to be creative. So the right side of your brain is the creative side. The right side of your brain is the sage. The sage always finds the gift in something. The right side of your brain is the explorer, right? So let me conduct another experiment. Can I borrow someone's phone? I usually bring it up. Does anyone have a cell phone, please? Quickly.
I promise I won't.
All right, here's your experiment, ladies and gentlemen. This is not a phone. What is it? A computer, a camera, what else? A mirror, good. What else?
A calendar.
A calendar. What is it? Hippie side, looking at something that might not be what you think it is. Thank you for letting me share your phone.
You've got a message. Oh.
So, interesting quick story. I had a resident once who went out with mom. I mean, went out with her daughter. Daughter was so excited, gonna take mom for a lobster roll. North Shore's got the best lobster rolls. Gonna take mom for a lobster roll, so excited. Comes back, brings mom back into her room and comes out and talks to me. And I said, how was it? It was awful. I said, oh, I'm so sorry. What happened? Okay, so I bring her to get a lobster roll. And she sits at the table and takes her fork and starts sticking it in her hair. I start to laugh. The daughter's looking at me going, that's not funny. And I said to the daughter, you're looking at your mom through your judge side. tap into your hippie. That is not a fork. What was it? Oh, what a fabulous restaurant my daughter brought me to. We had a lobster roll and a place to pick my perm out before I go back outside. Right? It was a hair pick. But when we look at something from our judge side, we only see it the way that we logically think it should be. Does that make sense? Okay. So I'm going to kind of skip past this a little bit because we don't have a whole lot of time. But I say there are three phases in your journey when someone has dementia or Alzheimer's. The first phase is, I know I don't know. This is when you might see someone's gait change. I notice a gait change a lot of times before they'll actually reveal a memory issue. And that's because the brain understands, it's the mainframe computer, that I'm feeling a little imbalanced, so I'm gonna start to shuffle because it's my safe way of keeping myself on the ground. We also notice a change in vocabulary. There is the beginnings of memory loss. And this is where they are the most fearful. Anxiety, depression, isolation, because they know that they don't know. Another quick story. A son took his dad out to the ball game, and dad had 5 hot dogs. The son just couldn't believe it. Dad just couldn't stop eating the hot dogs. He'd finish one, he'd go back, get another hot dog. And you know, at Fenway, they cost, you know, $50. So, you know, $250 later, so he brings dad back and says, Dad, tell Phyllis what you did at the ball game. And the dad's going, well, you tell her. Because that's usually that defense mechanism, if you recognize it. Well, you know where we went, you tell her, right? Because they don't know, but they're not going to admit that because they're very fearful right now. So he says, well, no, Dad, tell her about the hot dogs. I mean, the hot dog's dad. Oh my God, tell her. And the father's going, no, you could tell her the story. You could tell her. Finally, the son goes, Dad, don't you remember? You ate 5 hot dogs. 5 hot dogs. I missed half the game going down to get you those Franks. 5 of them. Tell her. Don't you remember, Dad? And Dad says, son, don't you remember? I have dementia. Right? I know I don't know, phase 1. Phase 2, as the dementia progresses, I say they begin to live in the now. They don't care about yesterday, when the guy almost ran me off Route 3. They don't care about tomorrow. They have no concept of either way. They care about right now. And the reason why I put a present up there is because I think it's a gift that they show us. How many of us really appreciate right now? That we're all sitting here. It's a wonderful evening. We got great people in the room. The cookies are low fat, no calories. It's fabulous, right? How many of us appreciate that? They do. They're very present. For them, it's euphoria. There's no more anxiety. Then there's phase 3. How many of you remember Back to the Future? We're aging ourselves, dating it right now. Back to the Future, where the kid goes back and he's actually living when his parents were teenagers. There are sometimes you get the privilege of being able to be with your loved one when they were back in time. Because as their memory deteriorates, perhaps they don't remember anything over the age of 25. When my grandmother had Alzheimer's, her memory deteriorated to the point where she was a flapper in her day, I found out. And boy, did she have a potty mouth. But she was a wild one. So I got to hang out with my grandmother, probably in her early 20s, and I played a role. I had a gentleman once who he was walking through the assisted living memory care. I was the executive director, and he was shaking all the doors, right? So of course the head nurse and the RCAs go, he's behavioral. He's trying to escape. What's the word we use? Elope. Okay? So I said, well, let's find out who he is, not who he was. We're still the same person. Who is he? So I walked up to him and I said, Mr. Smith, what are we doing? What are you doing? I'm walking down the hall, coming to see you and say hello. Aren't you supposed to be in detention right now? Where am I? I'm in school. I'm like, God, I could be a teacher. Nope, I'm a student. Okay. Well, yes, but I was on my way to the bathroom. Where's your slip? Slip, right, yeah. So he reaches in his walker, his basket, and pulls a tissue and says, take this slip and get back to detention. I said, yes, sir. Where was I? In his school. Who was he? Who is he? Retired principal. What do you think he was doing? Checking the doors, like he did every day at 3 o'clock. Behavioral? No. Speaking a different language. He was back to the future. So I'm gonna just move ahead. I will say, and I say it all the time, I don't believe in the word behavior. I do not believe that they are behavioral. I believe that they are simply communicating, and it is our hippie side that must figure out how they are communicating with us. No one wakes up in the morning with dementia going, I don't know, I'm gonna see how I can make my daughter angry today. It's just not what they do. But when they're frustrated or when they can't find the words because that communication has been cut, as we've shared stories, they might get frustrated. How many of us get frustrated? How many of us get fearful? Fearful can also be viewed as anger. So I don't believe that they are behavioral. 55% of the way they communicate and understand is nonverbal. So if you're having a bad day and you go up to them and you go, no, really, can I get you something? What is my body saying? I'm not in a good mood, even though I'm trying to be helpful. So again, if we view things from the hippie side, we'll understand that they view us non-verbally more than they understand the verbal words that are coming out of our mouth. Does that make sense? Have any of you experienced that? They can only understand one thing at a time. And we tend to go 100 miles an hour, especially in Massachusetts. I'm from Vermont. You people are in fifth gear all the time. So let me just zip through here for a second because I want to teach you a tool. I believe in my book I write that there are three E's of dementia: encouragement, engagement, and enrichment. We all deserve that in our lives, and nothing changes as we get older, with or without that diagnosis. And I promise you this, they didn't plan on it. Right? They didn't plan on it. I mean, I've raised my children. Thank God the boomerangs are gone, married. That means they don't come back, I think. That means they don't come back. I've raised my children, I've educated myself, I work hard, and someday when I retire, I'm gonna be one of those little old ladies on the cruise ship that drinks the little drink with the umbrella and pinches the little pool boys. I swear to God, my hippie's gonna be full blown. But I don't plan on going to the doctors to get my physical so I can go on the cruise ship and have someone say, oh my God, the doctor says, congratulations, you're finally retired and going on that cruise. Yes, I am. Good for you. By the way, you're not going to remember your life. Take care. Right? They don't plan on it. We don't plan on it. So if presented with it, they are entitled to the dignity that we deserve, that they deserve, because they came before us and paved the way. I call it the gracious generation that's before us. Does that make sense? All right, I'm gonna give you a tool. There's a few tools, but I'm gonna give you a tool. Which one do I wanna give you? Groundhog Day. Do you remember Groundhog Day? The movie Groundhog Day, where he wakes up every morning, Bill Murray, and he tries to do something different to make the outcome different. How many of us who are working with someone with dementia deal with the same question over and, oh yeah, the hands are going up, over and over? We have a very busy life. We get the doctor's appointments, we've gotten the groceries, we've given mom a shower, we're taking care of everything, and mom has now asked for the fifth time, what time is dinner? And you just can't possibly answer one more time. And it's at that moment that we forget ourselves that they don't remember. That short-term memory that sits right here, gone. Nothing sticks anymore. So this is for the caregiver to keep you busy. And I call it Groundhog Day. So here's your chore. Here's your task. Someone says to you, and I'm going to use that microphone. Someone says to you, what time is dinner? Yeah? I need an answer. What time is dinner? 5:30, thank you. What time is dinner? 5:30. I think I've heard that before. Well, okay. Hey, what time is dinner?
It's
5:30. 5:30. Am I getting a different answer every time? No. So if I don't like the first time, am I going to like it the third time? So I'm going to keep asking. Let me tell you something. I believe that when we have dementia, we like little conversations, right? How many of us like to go to a buffet and feel like we never really ate, right? It's delicious. So buffet it. So here's what we're going to do. What time is dinner? 5:30. Now I'm going to challenge you the second time I come back at you. You're not going to give me the same answer. So who's busy thinking of the next answer right now? The caregiver, completely preoccupied. What time is dinner?
It's just before 6 o'clock.
It's just before 6 o'clock. Do they have a concept of time? So what does that mean to me, really? Nothing. So I'm using you as an example. Thank you. So let's reverse it. Ask me what time dinner is, would you? No, you ask me. What time is dinner? I'm thinking we're going to eat in about a half hour. All right. Ask me the same question again. What time is dinner? I'm thinking we should do pork chops. What do you think? Little applesauce? That sounds good. Ask again. Do you see what I mean? Who's busy? The caregiver. And you're so busy trying to be creative with your hippie side, you won't get frustrated, I promise you. Because you're going, oh my God, I'm up to four. I'm up to five different answers. Do you see what I'm saying? It's a good feeling. I have time. I'll teach you one more. Does that make sense? Yeah? Dominoes. How many of you know dominoes? Do, 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 do. I know we're dating ourselves again, Judy. Dominoes. There you go. So dominoes, you line up one, and they knock the next one over. So remember what I said about a buffet, how they like little samples of meals? Okay. Some of us have to deal with difficult questions, like, I want to go home, or where's my dog, or where's my husband? These are painful conversations that for the caregiver, we can't even begin to imagine how we're going to answer these. So this is to keep, once again, the caregiver busy. If one of my residents or patients said, you know, where's my dog? I notice a lot of times caregivers go, oh, that's that question again. Would you like some tea? Now the dementia resident knows. I don't remember what I asked, but I'm pretty sure I wasn't talking about tea. They know, right? So we have to respect them. We have to acknowledge the conversation, but then move them away, and they'll follow you. So, where's my dog? Oh my goodness, that dog of yours was crazy. Oh, and I had a crazy cat one time. That cat would literally sleep in the sink. Doesn't matter what I put in the sink, it would just sleep in the sink. But you know what? Sleeping is a luxury right now because I can't even get 8 hours of sleep. I wake up all the time because the neighbor is just so loud. Well, of course, he's building a house and he thinks he could do it all hours of the night. It's crazy. What topic am I on right now?
House building, where did it begin? Where's my dog? And guess what? They'll follow you, and respectfully, they feel like they've had lots of conversations. It feels respectful, and they feel enriched, and they feel encouraged, because there's a positive interaction coming from you. Because I promise you, you're going to be so proud of yourself that you step them away from a difficult topic. But at the same time, they are feeling so full of joy because they have enjoyed so many different conversations, because every moment is a new moment for them. Does that make sense? Yeah? So this is my philosophy. I'm going to grow old without growing up. My kids will tell you I'll never grow up. But I want to thank you very much for just listening to a little bit of the hippie side of ourselves, and I want to appreciate you guys. Thank you very much for participating. But if you have questions, I'll take some questions if you have any. Programs for people who are trying to learn caregiving. The Alzheimer's Association has lots of different programs that are available, and the helpline is always something I've recommended to people. I train, there's people out there that will train. I think the best thing for a personal, someone who's not a professional caregiver but is a family caregiver, which is just as professional, family caregivers need to understand that it takes a village. They need to make sure that they ask for help too, yeah? 74% of those who care for someone with Alzheimer's or dementia take ill or pass away first. So a daughter who's taking care of mom needs to make sure she looks out for herself, because she will get sick. It's a lot. Especially when we see dad taking care of mom or mom taking care of dad, especially with the gracious generation, till death do us part in sickness and in health, but they never said anything about Alzheimer's and dementia. And it takes a lot of people. So for caregivers, I absolutely encourage them to seek support, to reach out and say, I need help. There's no shame in it, because it's what we need. Yeah.
It seems like a lot of the difficulty that comes from this comes from a place where we're afraid. I mean, to see somebody that you have trouble communicating with because they're in the process, I mean, the bottom line is they're losing their mind. Mm-hmm. And I don't think there's anything much more scary to most of us than right. The prospect that we might lose our mind or not be able to think. So I'm just, this is sort of a, how do you approach this with caregivers? Because
are you a caregiver yourself?
I've done some teaching and so on. So I think people need to learn to be not afraid. I mean, I think a lot of what you've said helps with that, because it's not seeing that other person as much as seeing ourselves.
Correct.
It's kind of scary. So to help a person see themselves and realize, I can do this and I don't have to be afraid. And I think it relates to the last thing you said too, is that lots of times the caregivers really suffer from this almost more than the person who's directly
affected. They absolutely do. And we were having little mini conversations before the lecture started about the medical field and how it's going to be a daunting task for our medical teams and the medical insurance and to take care of the caregivers. They're going to put a lot of pressure on our medical system. But to answer your question, the person that has dementia basically has learned to speak another language. Not many of us, although a lot of us from the gracious generation, a lot of them are bilingual, especially in this area. So they've just learned to speak a new language. That's all. So they're still there. They still have the same desires, the same natural needs that we have. I mean, one of the slides I didn't show is the need for comfort and food and shelter and all the basic needs that we want and have. That hasn't changed. For us who are with someone that has dementia or Alzheimer's, It's all we ask you to do is just love them. But love the side that's being presented now. It's fearful or it's joyful. It's a choice. We all have a choice. And I'm not downplaying it. It's very challenging. It's very challenging. So that's where, when you need to recharge your battery, a caregiver needs to go and recharge. Hang out with a group of friends and have some lunch. Get that recharge. But at the same time, the fact that they're still with you and they still love, they still feel, they might not remember that you gave them the hug, that my husband was there. So if your judge is looking for the validation, you have to check your ego at the door. But like our natural instincts from when we were little, that's a bad man, mommy. How did they know? It was naturally instinctive. They know that someone gave them love, and it actually stays with them for a very long time. So that you might not get the credit, right? Which sometimes we need, because we're tired. And we want you to know that I've been caring for you. But know that they feel that for a very long time. It stays with them. It's hard. It's hard. And sometimes it's hard to do that. But thank you for sharing. Yeah.
So I help look after an elderly person, and the anxiety is incredible. So I may deal sometimes with people are coming in the house, they're taking my clothes and replacing it with something else, or there's somebody been out in the doorway. So I may get a call and they've called the police, or I may go in and I will go and find the item that they've missed. And I'm not sure sometimes how the best way to get them away from, they're adamant that somebody's been in the house, because obviously their safety is my concern, but how do you get that person away from that anxiety where they're so fixed in that moment that they can't move?
So, there's lots of techniques that I'm sure people can share with you. My advice is to validate that someone was in the house. Not to play. So I never say patronize them. Like, oh, and look it, there are fingerprints. Don't do that. But say, okay, so you know what? You and I have to play detective now. We gotta find out where they hid the stuff. They came in and hid the stuff. How dare they? We have a lot to do today. They're interrupting our fun. Do you see what I mean? Because the words you're using, the tone you're taking, which is encouraging and let's do it together, it will bring down that anxiety because you're validating, right? If we say, no, no one was here, what's a bad word you use with someone with dementia? No. It stops them in their track. They don't understand what you just said. You said no, but what did I say? But that's negative. I feel it, but I don't know what. So don't, that spirals them even more. Play the hippie role with them. Don't patronize it. Don't take it to the point where you're doing the fingerprint dusting. But well, you know what? They didn't steal it. So don't ever, but don't say no. Just say, well, they hit it again. You know, I wish they would just come in and tell me they need to borrow something. Let's you and I go find it again, because we have lots of fun things we need to get done. Do you know what I'm saying? And they will then, because they squirrel. They squirrel. They hide stuff. And the beauty is they can't remember where they hid it. So it's the best hide and seek game you'll ever play, and they're pretty good. Do you see what I'm saying? But if you're in that state of mind right there, that's what they're going to feed from. If you're in that, oh, I wish I could just get rid of this anxiety and I feel bad for him and or her or whoever, they're gonna feel that. So be like, again? Telling you, I wish they would just ask. Let's go find it. You know what I mean? And they'll feel that you're not hyped up and they won't be hyped up, I promise you. Try it. It's fun. You had a question? Sorry.
It's not actually a question, but I just want to say thank you for this, because I have been a PCA in the past, taking care of a dementia patient.
Yeah.
But one thing, especially hearing what you're saying, that touched me more was, like you said, living back in the future. that is so good. But the thing is, a lot of people or families that we help out there, they don't know about that. And it was a very good example that you gave, talking about the principal, because he was living in the past, and when he used to be young, he goes check the students, and he has this paperwork and so on. So now in this stage of dementia, he kind of go back into that future.
Yes.
So now, as a caregiver, you try to redirect or to tell him that, okay, why don't we do this? Because you want to make him feel that comfort and to know that. But on the other hand, the families, because they don't understand exactly how the patient, what the patient goes through, they don't seem to think that you are doing anything good for their patient.
That's where my mission is to teach this hippie philosophy, because it's not the medical understanding for the caregivers or the family. It's something tangible. Do you know what I mean? When I had an Alzheimer's community, my third shift, of course, third shift loves to go, oh, good. They're going to be sleeping. I'll do a little laundry, catch up on my reading. I had a resident who was up all night. Yep. 11 to 7, and they would go, oh my God, we can't get her to bed, we can't redirect her. And she's walking around and she's yelling at us. I loved her, by the way, I should have put her on my payroll. She was a retired nurse, worked third shift, and she kept my RCAs in order. Oh yeah, right? It was the best shift I had. So that's, the family would feel bad. I'm sorry my mom's up all night. No, thank you. As a matter of fact, I should put her on my payroll because she's keeping an eye on my place when I'm not there. But it's a matter of now you taking this message and trying to help them understand that when the memory deteriorates, it doesn't deteriorate in any specific order. It's not like every 3 years you have dementia, you deteriorate 10 years in your memory. There's no rhyme nor reason or methodology. But at some point, sometimes, they do land in a place where they stay for a while. And it's cool. It's kind of cool, you know? Did you have a question?
About 2.5 years ago, my mother reached the tipping point. She fell down the front stairs and couldn't stay at home anymore. So I always felt with her dementia, I was the one who had to give her the reality testing. So one day in the rehab center, she said to me, am I in heaven? And I said, look around you. Does this place look like heaven to you? And her answer was, well, maybe I've been a little bit bad. And I was like heartbroken for so many days about that. So I really have been like telling myself to go with the flow of her. So now when I say to her, I'm your daughter, Mary Ann, she'll say, you're not my daughter, you're my mother. I'm like, oh yeah, I'm the best mother ever. You know, so I keep trying because it's so hard.
That's what mother is. Someone that she loves. So you're still someone that is very important to her, right? I mean, I'll take that all day long. When my grandmother had dementia, if I had a really, really bad day, I would go in, she'd go, oh, there's that beautiful girl. I'd be like, mm-hmm. Right? But if I had a really bad day, I swear I did this, I would go back out. And I'd count to 10, because she doesn't remember I was there. And I'd go back in. And she'd go, oh, there's that beautiful girl. I loved it, because I needed that, right? It's that. It doesn't matter where you are with them. It doesn't matter. It's that connection. It's that moment. It's that now. Does that make sense? And she'll love you for it. And if she thinks that's heaven, good. Right? Because it means it feels okay to her. That's a good thing, actually. It's a validation that you should be like, okay, I got her in the right place, you know? Yeah. So thank you, yeah.
Any recommendations if you needed to look for an assisted living, what we should bring?
So assisted livings, I've run several, I build them now, but assisted livings, it's all about touch, taste, feel. It's not about brick and mortar. It's how something feels to you. I would say go and don't schedule a tour. Ever. Ever. You walk in,
and you want to see what it feels like. They should be prepared all the time because that's what your mother or loved one would be dealing with, right? It shouldn't be like, oh, we have a tour coming in at 2. So make sure Henry's teeth are in, right? No, show up whenever you're supposed to. That's what I always recommend. And I always said you can come and to my building 24 hours a day. On a full moon, just be careful. We might be having a party, just saying, right? But 24 hours a day, you should be able to show up at any time. What you're looking for, I always say, is make sure they understand the person. Make sure they know that there's a person behind the disease. If they talk more about the way they can care for Alzheimer's than they're not finding out about your loved one, it's probably not the right program. They should be asking all about who you're trying to find this home for. My opinion. I always want to know about mom or dad, right? If that helps. So thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Hi, I'm Judy Van Koyman, the co-chair of this forum, and I have the pleasure of introducing now J. Michael Winward. He's an independent dance artist based in Boston with influence in American-style ballroom, ballet, contemporary, somatic dance practices. His work places a strong focus on building connection to one's body, oneself, one's audience, connection between dance partners, connection within and across communities. In 2016, he founded Steps in Time, a program that brings social dance workshops to senior and elder care facilities throughout Greater Boston. Michael dances for Peter DeMuro, Public Displays of Emotion, which I know Peter personally, and he's awesome. He teaches private lessons and leads a variety of creative performance projects at the Dance Complex in Cambridge. And they put on some phenomenal performances there. So if you ever get a chance, the Dance Complex in Cambridge. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce J. Michael Winward.
Thank you, Judy, and thank you, Dr. Carlson, for inviting me here. So my name is Michael, and as Judy said, I dance for Peter DeMuro Public Displays of Motion, which is an intergenerational contemporary dance company. Prior to that, my career was at the Fred Astaire Dance Studios, where I was a professional ballroom dancer. And I did that for 7 years, and honestly, I just got tired of putting on fake Tanner and rhinestones all the time. And I wanted to do something else, and so I decided to start taking my teaching and into assisted living facilities, independent subsidized living facilities, and that branched off into memory care facilities, as well as councils on aging. And the parts about connection, what I really found when I started thinking about my work and Peter's work, which is really values the person before the dancer and different ways of using dance for community engagement, it really was about connection, because there's a feeling of connection when you're doing ballroom or social dancing correctly. You feel connected to your partner. But also, I mean, you know, like I said, it's kind of, you get sick of fake Tanner and rhinestones after a while. And for me, it was really about getting rid of that surface, let's make it look great, and well, let's try to do something that's actually going to have an impact on people broadly. So that's a brief introduction. The rest of my presentation is actually going to be happening in the back of the room, where I'm going to ask you all to join me right now. So right underneath that basketball hoop right there, if you wouldn't mind coming back there with me. So one of the things that I really found that was surprising when I started working in memory care is that people know how to dance. Like, this was something that you grew up doing, was social dancing. And if you didn't, then you were kind of the uncool one. So it's fun that it's kind of coming back. And so I'm going to teach you a couple of social dance skills. If I could get everybody to face, come join me out over here and face this direction for me, please. And spread out. We've got plenty of room over here. Let's move over in this direction. So what we're all about to do, you're all going to learn 5 basic elements of social ballroom dancing. If you can master these 5 elements, then you can learn any of the popular dances, which are very popular in many of the facilities where I work. Let me find some examples of music that you can play. So this is a foxtrot.
Very jazzy, sophisticated kind of dance, right? You learn these five elements, you could dance a foxtrot. This is a waltz. You play this, you'll get a whole room of people singing along, which is amazing. That's another fascinating thing. This is a very elegant dance, right? It's like the prince at the princess at the ball. This is the waltz, right? You learn these five elements. You're gonna be able to jitterbug, all right? And I have been doing these things, these dances for years, and believe me, I never thought that I was going to see the reaction that I had when I started going to some of the places where I now teach, and it's really quite amazing. So by the end of these 15 minutes, you're not going to have a mastery of all these things, but hopefully you'll feel like you've got some of the basic skills, and if you wanted to learn more, I certainly encourage that. All right, everybody, face this direction for me, please. Element number one, I know you can all do it because I've seen you do it already. It's walking. So it doesn't matter what foot you start with. You're going to take walking steps forward, one foot right in front of the other. There we go. And before we hit the table, we're going to stop and one foot right behind the other. Back it up. So we're walking backward. And before we hit the basketball hoop, we're going to stop and we're going to walk forward. Very nice. And then we stop. One more time, take it to the back. All right, everybody, give yourselves a round of applause. You just learned element number one, which is the walking element. Now, yeah, woo! Element number two is known as the movie theater sidestep element. This is what you do when you're in the movie theater. You have to go this way to get to the bathroom or this way to get to the concession stand. So let's all start with the left foot. You're gonna do a side together over there. You're gonna go to the side and close your feet together. And we're gonna repeat that. You're gonna go side, together, side, together, side, together, side. Very nice. Before we hit that wall, we're going to do the same thing with the right foot. You're going to sidestep that way. So we're going to go side, together, side, together, side, together. How about one more time to the left? Side, together, side, together, side, together. Once more to the right. Side, together, side, together, side, together. And very nicely done. Give yourselves a hand. That's element number two. That's the sidestep. So you've got your walking step and you've got your sidestep. You put them together and you get element number three, which is the box step. It's gonna look like this. Everybody, please take one walking step forward on your left foot. Now with the right foot, do a sidestep toward that wall. You're gonna go side and close your feet, right? That's gonna leave your right foot free. Please take a backward walk with your right foot. And then with the left, you're gonna go side and close your feet together. So that's a box step. It is so called because it will draw a box on the floor. So again, we're going to take the left foot. You're going to walk forward on the left. And then you're going to go to the side and close your feet. Now backward on the right foot. And then you're going to go to the side and close your feet. So it's going to go forward on the left foot, side and close your feet. Backward on the right foot, side and close your feet. Again, forward on the left and side and close your feet. And back on the right, and side and close your feet. Once more, forward on the left, and side and close your feet. And back on the right, and very nicely done. There's element number three. Oh, now you're clapping already. All right, so that's the box step. The fourth element is going to be a rock step. You can do it a few different ways. We're all gonna start with the left foot. You're going to rock onto your left foot, and then you're gonna rock back onto your right foot. Yeah, so that's a side rock. Let's do that a few times. Rock to the left, rock to the right, rock to the left, rock to the right, over to the left, over to the right, over to the left, and over to the right. That looked good. What I saw of that looked good. Now, everybody, take your left foot. We could do a back rock, meaning you're gonna take your left foot, rock back onto it, and then forward onto the right. So you're gonna go back on the left, forward on the right, back on the left, forward on the right. Back on the left, and forward on the right, and back on the left, and forward. One more time you go, back on the left, and nicely done. You could also do that same thing with your right foot back. So take your right foot back, and you're gonna go back on the right, forward on the left, back on the right, forward on the left, back on the right, and forward on the left, and back on the right, and forward. One more time you go, back on the right, and very nice. That's element number four. That's your rocking step. The fifth and final element is a triple step. Do we have any idea how many pieces might be in a triple step? Three, very good. Usually I get a couple of fake answers in that one. There are three steps. It's gonna go like this. Please take your left foot, you're gonna go to the side. Close your feet together, and then one more to the side. That's a triple to the left. You're now gonna do the same thing to the right. You're gonna go to the side, close your feet together, one more to the side, and that's a triple to the right. All together, it's gonna sound like this. We triple to the left, and triple to the right, and triple to the left, and triple to the right, and triple to the left, and triple to the right. Once more, triple to the left, and triple to the right. Very good, give yourselves a hand. I didn't tell you that there would be a quiz, but element number one, who remembers what it was? It went over here, it went back over there. Anybody remember? Walking, yes, very good. Element number two, it went over this side. Yes, side step. You put them together, you got the third element, kind of went like this. Box step, the fourth one, there was rock, yes, rock. And then the fifth and final element went over here. Triple, very good, nicely done. You all know how to dance, we'll see you later. Not really. I mean, yes, I'm sure there's a little bit of that, but that's the beginning of it. And again, those are the basic building blocks of any of the dances, social partner dances that we're gonna learn tonight. Now, here's what we're going to do next. We're going to take the dance I find the most inspiring and the one that, when we do it in memory care, oftentimes people say, what did my mother do? What was she doing? She was doing the jitterbug. Fascinating that this is probably one of the most popular ones and the ones that I find that people just end up telling me they did it all the time. So what I'd like is, could I get one row just here? This is going to be the row of leaders. Anyone that cares to lead, you can be in this row. And then followers, I'm going to have you over here. So if you care to follow, you're going to be in this row. In fact, it doesn't really matter what you care to do because eventually I'm just going to make it that everybody has a partner. So why don't we have, could I get a few volunteers to come over here for me and face that direction? So why don't we step over here? Yeah, do you mind? Would you mind coming here? How about a couple more? Would you? All right, great. Good. So eventually you're gonna be looking across the way at your partner. So we're gonna even this out as much as possible, good. Would you mind, could we come down here just a tad? All right, good, good. All right, look across the way. Do you see somebody to dance with? Great, that's gonna be your dance partner, at least for now. So we're gonna do the jitterbug now. You're all leaders. Leaders, here's how this is going to work, right? We're gonna do the fourth element. That's your rocking step element. So what you're gonna do, would everybody please take your left foot and rock side to side with me. So you're gonna rock over to your left, and then rock over to your right. Very good, let's do that a few times. You're gonna go rock to the left, rock to the right, rock to the left, rock to the right, rock to the left, rock to the right, and rock to the left, and a couple more times, rock to the left, rock to the right, and rock to the left, and very nicely done. How do they look? I thought so too. Now followers, here's what you're going to do. You're gonna match your partner. So you're gonna start on your right foot. So would everybody please rock to this direction first. You're gonna rock over to your right and then to your left. Rock to your right, rock to your left, and rock to the right, rock to the left, rock to the right, and rock to the left, rock to the right, and rock to the left, and rock to the right, and very nicely done. Leaders, how'd they look? Good, very good. I will tell everybody, so if I'm dancing a jitterbug with somebody that's really, they say I never did do this before, I'm not quite, they don't feel quite comfortable with it right away, this is all I stick to. There is a second part, but this right here, this is enough. I'm gonna show you what it sounds like. So if you wanted to dance just that much with a partner, it's going to go to the rhythm like this. So to this rhythm, it's gonna go. One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, nice. Two, one, two, one, two, one, two. All right, you guys look good. Here's what you're gonna do. Take a few steps forward and find somebody to dance with. Oops, sorry. Do you have somebody? All right, take them by two hands. Right, so two hand holds, like this. All right, yep, just by two hands. Now we're going to start this direction first. Five, six, here we go.
One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two.
Johnny B. Good. He used to carry his guitar in a gun in his sack. Go sipping.
You guys are fabulous.
Bowling and everything sitting in the shade. Strumming with the rhythm that the driver made.
Hey, very nicely done. Give yourselves a hand. That was great. So that's part one. Could I have everybody separate right back where you were? That's part one, right? And like I say, that's sometimes the only thing I do is just that rock side to side. It's a lot of fun. With the right song, even that by itself is great. We're going to combine that with the back rock. So this is the second part of the jitterbug. Leaders, you're going to rock side to side with me, side to side. You're going to take your left foot, and you're going to do the back rock with your left foot. You're going to go back and then forward again. So let's put those two together. You rock side to side, then back and forth. Again, side to side, back and forth. Again, side to side, back and forth, and side to side, back and forth. One more, side to side, back and forth. That looked good. Followers, here's what you're going to do. This is the funny part. You're going to do side to side, side to side. You're also going to go back and forth. So your right foot has to go this way, back and forth. Again, side to side and back and forth and side to side and back and forth and side to side. And one more time we go, side to side and back. Very nice. Looked good. Before I put you together, I want you to be aware that that is a small back rock. If you take a big back rock, you get whiplash. So we don't want that, all right? Find the person you were just dancing with. Take them in a two-hand hold. Gently, grab your partner, gently, and outside the bathing suit line. All right, does everybody have somebody? So what it's going to look like is this. Side to side, we're going to rock away from each other, all right? We're going to do it slowly before we put it to music, all right? I'm going to be in the middle to kind of steer you. Ready? Five, six, here we go. Side to side and rock away. And side to side, rock away and toward. Good. Side to side and backward rock. Side to side and backward rock. Side to side and backward rock. Good. Side to side and backward rock. Not bad at all. Not bad. Very good. Nice. So, the last thing we're going to talk about before we put it to music, and then we're going to call it a night for your dancing for tonight, is the rhythm. So the rhythm is going to go like this. Your side rocks are slow, slow, slow. Your back rocks are quick, quick, quick. So all together, it's going to go like this. Slow, slow. Quick, quick, slow, slow, quick, quick, side, side, back rock. In fact, could I get the leaders and the followers to separate one more time so we can do both parts? Sorry. You'll get back to them in just 1 second. So again, we're going to do just the leaders part. Leaders, you're going to go with your left foot first. You're going to go side to side and back rock, side to side and back rock, side to side and a back rock, side to side and back rock, side to side and back rock. Good. Followers, here's what it's going to look like from your end. You're going to take your right foot. You're going to go side to side, a back rock, side to side and back rock, side to side, a back rock. Slow, slow, quick, quick, slow, slow, quick, quick, slow, slow. Very nice. Let's find that partner you were just dancing with. Take him by the hands, two hands. Ready? We're going to try it slowly with no music before we put music on. And so, five, six, here we go. Side to side and a back rock. Side to side and a back rock. Side to side and a back rock. Side to side and back rock. Side to side and a one more time. Side to side and nicely done. Give yourselves a hand. Very good. All right. We're going to do a practice rhythm, which is the slower rhythm, and then we're going to do the up-to-tempo one, all right? I'm going to put a nice little foxtrot on, so we're going to do a slower jitterbug rhythm. So listen first. Getting on all night, yeah. Why don't you vacate the gate while I check it out? It is too good for me, yeah. Hey, ma. You got a fine brown frame. Could be your name. You look good to me, 'cause all I can see is your fine brown frame.
get it on. Now you got a fine brown brain. Oh, baby, won't you tell me your name? You are solid with me, girl. All I can see is your fine brown brain.
That was good. Do you want to try it to the fast rhythm? Just once? All right. Get ready for it. Nice. Any questions about that much? I mean, even just by itself, right? Let's gather in a circle. Kumbaya. Let's get one big circle. So before we finish, that looked very good. Like I said, this is your crash course. So if it didn't feel 100% tonight, I definitely encourage you to learn more, because it's a great skill to have. And it's been really rewarding and fulfilling for me to be able to bring it into memory care facilities. And if you do decide that you want to dance with your loved one, a couple of little tips that I've gotten, which have been really beneficial. One is that it's really good, important to emphasize making eye contact. Because especially if it's new to you, you're like, oh geez, what are my feet doing? I mean, really, it doesn't matter. The big thing is to be able to move foot to foot with your partner and try to encourage them to look you in the eye. Because that's, you know, it's about connecting with somebody more than it being, oh, this felt amazing, you were so good. It was good no matter what. That's a key, right? Another thing is, as opposed to, so I'll show you just a quick example, right? If I did a waltz with somebody, I'll play a little Nat King Cole. So normally a waltz is a box step, right?
Walk, side, close. Walk, side, close.
This is how I would do it, like at a competition. If I'm dancing with a partner who happens to have dementia, it's going to be a lot easier to get your partner to walk forward on the rhythm than try to negotiate this crazy box step. So it's going to sound and look like this. One, two, three. I just sort of keep an eye over my left shoulder. You can go all the way around the ballroom like this, right? And your partner's walking forward rather than trying to get them to walk backward, which can be daunting and challenging. And I think the big thing is just encouraging, right? No matter what, very good job. That was amazing. It was wonderful to dance with you. So that's a little bit of what I do. And give yourselves one more big round of applause, because you looked great. Yeah, and if we have any questions, we can ask them here, we can go over there, whatever we think is best. Yes?
How do the rest, you know, people act and respond to that? How do you know to respond?
A lot of the time, the biggest responses I get is, oh, I haven't done this in so long. The things I get, when I was working for a more extended period of time in the same facility, it was really exciting, because people would go from being totally nonverbal, but they weren't talking to me. Would you like to dance? Nope. And eventually somebody would say yes. And then eventually this same particular person I'm thinking of started telling me about going out dancing with her husband, and we used to do this all the time. So the big thing I hear first is, I haven't done this in so long. And I think the second level of that, which is really exciting, is when it's, oh, let's talk about where did you go dancing? And those conversations happen, and that's really exciting, because I'm finding out about places in Boston that have closed down, and you can't go dancing there anymore. But there's a whole history, social dance history in town, that's one of the some of the more common things that I hear. All over Greater Boston, about 25 centers that I serve at the moment, yeah.
This would be great for Jack Satterhouse. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're a social worker. No, one of the partners I have, he's actually a priest. And I, from the very first moment, like I say, sometimes it's like it takes a few rounds of would you like to dance, and eventually people say yes, but from the very first moment I say, hey, would you like to dance? He goes, yeah, sure. And then we've been dancing ever since, so. Not everybody responds that way. It's nice if one of the people that works there is willing to be a partner, especially if it's a woman, because some men are just like not inspired to dance with me, but if it was a, you know, a woman, they'd be more inspired to dance with them, so it depends, you know. Can I answer any other questions about that? Oh, thank you. Thank you. It's a lot of fun. Thank you again.
Okay, welcome back, everyone. I forgot to introduce myself before. I'm David Houle, and I've been with the Forum on Tolerance since 1996. So we have two more presenters still this evening, and Catherine Ricketson is a licensed social worker who has worked both professionally and as a volunteer with Alzheimer's patients and also their caregivers. She has served as the manager of early stage programs for the Alzheimer's Association and has worked with families and communities, including councils on aging, to encourage programs to help families cope. She has also been a family caregiver, caring for patients with Alzheimer's disease for many, many years. Also, we have with us today Leonor Buitrago, I hope I got that right, I tried really hard. And Leonor has been working with the Latino community for about 10 years. She previously worked at the Alzheimer's Association in New York City, the chapter there, as well as the chapter in Rochester, New York. In her different roles at the association, she has provided Alzheimer's education to the Latino community, to health workers, healthcare workers, and also families affected by the disease. She currently oversees diversity outreach in the chapter, and she works in collaboration with other health organizations, community and media outlets for events aimed to raise awareness on Alzheimer's in the Latino community in Massachusetts and New Hampshire. So we welcome both Kathy and Leonor.
Hi there. So I have been a caregiver for many, many years. My journey with Alzheimer's began unknowingly in 1991 when I took my dad to a movie and he got up out of his seat, I thought, to go to the men's room, and he didn't come back. And when I went looking for him, finally very concerned, he not only wasn't in the men's room after I got a very nice man to go in there and check, he wasn't in the movie theater, he wasn't outside, he had taken a walk down the block and we eventually found him. At that time, I had never heard the term dementia, I had never heard the term Alzheimer's disease, I knew nothing about these things. I was young and had two little children, two little toddlers, and someone told me, your dad might have Alzheimer's disease, you should call the Alzheimer's Association. And I did, and it changed my life because that was when help arrived. So I'm gonna talk to you a little bit, if you're struggling with a person in your family that has some memory issues, I'm just gonna give you the basics so that you understand what you're dealing with, because we've heard some of that tonight, especially when Phyllis so wonderfully talked about your left brain and your right brain. But there are a few things that I think we just need to understand as basics about dementia and Alzheimer's disease. So we have typical age-related changes, and if you're over 50 like me, I once heard the top neurologist in Boston say, if you go into the kitchen and you ask yourself, why did I come into the kitchen? You're just over 50. But if you go into the kitchen and you say, what room am I in? You need to see the doctor, okay? So I always thought that was a good rule of thumb. But, you know, we all have age-related changes, and sometimes we miss the monthly payment on something. We forget which day we're doing something and we'll remember it later. We might want to recall who, you know, what movie we saw last year and what was the name of it and who starred with it. And sometimes, as we age, we struggle a little more with word finding, finding the right word, and you notice that difference, just like the day you notice you might need glasses. And losing things from time to time. And we cope with that with our in our normal everyday life by retracing back our steps and hopefully finding the object, okay? So when we have problematic changes, they look more like memory changes that disrupt your daily life when you forget an important appointment or you mix up that day. Or you have challenges really planning out your day. Or you have confusion with time and space. And you may be aware of some of these changes, but you may not know that you also have trouble sometimes with visual imaging. Literally, your spatial vision is changing. Or in spatial relationships, like where, you know, grabbing this microphone or walking. You may have some trouble with your balance. These are changes that you may feel are a little bit more problematic. If it's taking you longer to speak, longer to write, that can be a sign. And you might realize that your judgment is a little poor about time or how you're doing something. Somebody may point it out to you, okay? And that may cause you to withdraw more from work or social activities because you're sensing changes, like Phyllis said, knowing that you don't know can sort of creep up on you. And your loved ones may also point out to you, your best friends, that you're having some changes in your mood and personality. Oh, that's not like you. And they're sensing a change in you, and you might want to pay attention to that. But what is dementia, okay? So there is always confusion between what is dementia and what is Alzheimer's disease. And we want to point out the difference because it's very, very important. There is Alzheimer's disease and then there are dementias that are often associated with other illnesses. So dementia, as we're experiencing it, is changes in your memory, your language, your thought, again, your behaviors, possibly your moods, and your planning and your organizing, okay? But as you see here, there are types of dementia that are associated to other diseases. Dementia with Lewy bodies disease. You may have never heard of that, often associated to Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's disease is what you are suffering from. The dementia may be a byproduct of the Parkinson's disease. A mixed dementia is what we call mixed vascular dementia. That can come with stroke. That can come with hardening of the arteries or other atherosclerosis conditions. And frontotemporal dementia is now a differentiated diagnosis in the families of dementia. So we're getting better at diagnosing dementia and the way it progresses, and we're coming up with different diagnoses for them, differential diagnoses like frontotemporal dementia. But Alzheimer's disease stands alone. It is different from all those other dementias because it is a progressive, irreversible disease that is eventually terminal. So just remember that Alzheimer's stands alone. And if your loved one is experiencing dementia, it is really important to go and have a full diagnostic workup so that you can understand what it is you're really, really suffering from. Especially with our aged parents, because if you've ever cared for your aged parent, you know sometimes they can be perfectly fine one day, and then the next day they're suddenly confused. That could be dehydration. That could be a urinary tract infection, or it could be a thyroid disorder. And then they'll be fine once those things are remedied. So sometimes people jump to the conclusion when someone's older, they're confused, it must be dementia. Well, you really need a full physical workup, and now doctors are getting so much better at diagnosing these kinds of ailments and helping you to understand what it is that you're dealing with, okay? So Alzheimer's disease stands alone as a progressive disease, but you need to understand it is the most common form of dementia. And of course, it has no cure. And now affecting, as Phyllis brought up earlier and Dr. Bonner, over 5 million Americans. And because there are 75 million baby boomers, we know that number is going to rise precipitously. So what are your major risk factors for dementia? This is the other thing that people always want to know. Age is the number one risk factor for Alzheimer's. So as you're aging, your risk goes up. So that by the time you're 85 years old, you know, your risk could be even 50-50 of getting Alzheimer's or dementia. The incidence is higher in women. That's always scary, but that's because there are more women and because they live longer. Down syndrome is also correlated with Alzheimer's disease, and it's very, very interesting to see how much we've learned from the Down syndrome community that we have been able to apply to our care of Alzheimer's patients. And your family history can definitely increase your risk. Now, if you're someone like me, dementia came to our family with no precedent. But that was because my parents lived longer than their parents, far longer. So you may not have a family history going back generations. It may be just the generation before you, and you may not have seen it coming. You may have had no inkling of it at all. And there are genes involved with Alzheimer's, but really these days doctors are very, very good at diagnosing the changes that I'm discussing here, which gives you a much greater sense of how we diagnose it today. 30 years ago, we didn't have these tools, and now we do. So we alluded earlier to the stages of Alzheimer's disease, and these three stages are the basics to understand. The early stage is the recent memory loss, and as Dave said, I ran the early stage programs for the Alzheimer's Association, and the emphasis on early stage is that you are, when you're told that you're now living with Alzheimer's, we put the emphasis on living. You are living with Alzheimer's, okay? And there's a lot of life. Even though you've gotten this very, very scary diagnosis for yourself or your loved one. I also was the manager for early onset families, and that is people under the age of 65. And it surprises people that there are people in their 30s and their 40s and their early 50s who get diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. Most people think this is a disease for seniors over 65. But sadly, there are people who get it at an earlier age. There are many causes for this. For the extremely young, it often is a specific gene, and it is in their family, and there's a strong familial history. But for people in their 40s and 50s, can be very blindsided by the fact that it is Alzheimer's. And if any of you saw the movie Still Alice, or you read that book, the character is 50 years old and is shocked to discover that she can be diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. So the early stage is the recent memory loss and difficulty managing, and that's when Phyllis was talking about they know what they don't know. The middle stage, difficulty with language, problems keeping track, may need some help with their grooming. Now things are progressing. You're getting a little further into that caregiving role if your loved one has the diagnosis. And then we get to the late stage. And the late stage is what the media often portrays with Alzheimer's, and so our minds tend to go straight to late stage. Oh my gosh, we're going to be completely non-functional. Well, it's a journey that is so individualized. At the association, we say, one person with Alzheimer's disease is just one person. And I can tell you now, having walked this journey for, well, three times, it's so different with each person. And in that stage, your caregiver will be the person who is the most, you know, stressed at that point, has to take very good care of themselves, and you will need a village, because your long and your short-term memory are affected at that point. So, if you get a diagnosis in today's medical visit, you're often going to get a diagnosis of MCI. Have any of you ever heard of that? MCI, mild cognitive impairment. And basically, that's what we call the watchful waiting phase. Could be Alzheimer's, could be another form of dementia, or it could be something else. So they start to test you, they get a baseline, and every couple of months they're going to test you again. And sometimes, and this can be really frustrating, it could take a year and a half to really come up with the diagnosis of dementia. And this frustrates families and it frustrates caregivers. If your mother lives in California and you live in New York, you're flying out there trying to get an answer from these doctors. What are we dealing with here? It takes time. But this is actually a big advancement in our diagnostic process. In 25 years ago, we didn't have it, and it was much, much harder. So at that point, you can develop a relationship with the healthcare team. You can really start to talk to the doctor. If you are going to be a caregiver for a loved one, you want to get all of your legal affairs in order so that you can talk to the doctor with the HIPAA rules, and grow the support system within your families, your friends, communities. If your parent doesn't live with you, or it's a sibling or your best friend, who around them is going to be partnering with you? Or if you're the person with the diagnosis, building up your support system at this point. You have the ability to do it. And educating yourself about the disease will give you a little bit more confidence at that early stage. So the Alzheimer's Association has a lot of different programs, and we're going to touch upon them in the question period. But the most important program, I think, is the 24-hour helpline. That's what I called all those years ago. It wasn't 24 hours a day then, but it is now, and it's national. So if you are living in Massachusetts and you need to call up at midnight, you are going to get a care consultant to speak with you about a behavior that may be very, very challenging, or something that might be scary for you, or you have a general question. You're going to get an answer, and they're going to call you back. It's a helpline, not a hotline. So if you call and leave your number, they are going to call you back. And they're going to call you back within a very reasonable amount of time. So I always like to refer to the helpline as the cavalry. They really come and they help you in your moment of need. And what I really love about the helpline is that you can call it 100 times. You know, it's not just, you know, you're three times and you're up. You can call the helpline at any time. So that becomes another partner for you. There's also support groups, education programs, and I can't tell you how wonderful these programs are. For caregivers, we have programs called Care for the Caregiver. You learn about behaviors. You learn how to handle situations like you were shown earlier. No question is insignificant, and at each stage, you learn and you feel equipped to deal with the changes that are coming your way. Now, Leonor is going to talk about the cultural diversity programs that we have. So when we're talking about dementia-friendly communities, we're also taking into consideration the different cultures within that community. Like in a city like Lynn, you have so many diverse cultures. I'd like to tell you a little story about just my own family culture. So I'm Irish and Italian, okay? I don't know why, but in New York, a lot of people are half Irish and half Italian. And I've dealt with dementia in both my Italian family and my Irish family. And I've been lucky enough to go to Ireland and to Italy. And I was fascinated once I became aware. Now wherever I go, it's like anything else when you get, oh, you become aware of something, you kind of see it everywhere. I remember that when I got pregnant, all I saw was pregnant women everywhere. All of a sudden, they just appeared out of nowhere. I had never noticed them before. I was like, where did all these pregnant people come from? Well, in Ireland, sitting in an Irish pub in Dublin with my mother, I suddenly noticed that there was a big family sitting around a table, and clearly, Granddad had dementia. And I couldn't take my eyes off of this family, because here I was outside of the United States. We were in a pub. Everyone was drinking. Not something you usually do with your dementia patient here in the United States. Well, people were singing. People were playing music. Some people were, you know, tapping their toes. If you've ever been out on St. Patrick's Day, you've seen the whole drill in Boston. He was singing, he was clapping, he was tapping his feet, he was part of the whole scene, and he had the biggest smile on his face, and everybody else was taking it in their stride. He was part of the scene, he was very much included. When they got up to leave, I saw how impaired he was, but you would not really have known. Just having him sitting there with his friends, his family, he was part of the scene. And that scene was very, very familiar to him, probably part of his very long-term memory, probably been doing this all of his life. So singing, dancing, music, and at the top of his lungs, believe me, there were no words. It was just the sound. And it was just so enlightening for me, because here in the U.S. at that time, we were more about separating our dementia patients or leaving them out of family activities, maybe not taking them out of assisted living when we had big family parties or weddings or funerals or anything like that. So I think we're catching up. I think we're catching up in the United States now, and we're making people with dementia more part of everyday life. There's a lot of living when a diagnosis of Alzheimer's. Doesn't mean it isn't scary, doesn't mean that it isn't something daunting, but when you can incorporate it into your everyday life, it really is true what was said earlier and what Dr. Bonner said. There are many gifts for us in the journey. When my dad died of Alzheimer's disease, many people said to me, oh gosh, I'm so, so sorry for your loss. I guess it's such a huge relief. And I wasn't relieved. I still didn't want to give him up. Even then, I still had him, and there was a lot of life left there. Now I'm taking care of my in-laws, and when my mother-in-law sees us, she has no language. She doesn't know where her son, daughter-in-law, grandson, but we warm to her when we walk in, and she warms to us. And it's all smiles. And we wouldn't miss this for the world. People say, oh, it must be so depressing when you go to visit. No. We love going to visit because we just get all the love. And before she had the disease, she was actually a very reserved person. It's all gone. She's a big hugger now. Big hugger. Kiss her, too. And she sings. So she can no longer say words in English. She can no longer talk to us. So when we come, she sings. And we can sing. So whatever tune she's humming, we hum too. And this is language to her, and now it's language to us. So there's still a lot of joy. Yes, there is heartbreak, there's challenges, it's very difficult at times, but still we have these moments of joy. So I'm gonna turn it over to Leonor now to talk about our cultural diversity and programs throughout the Commonwealth.
Okay, good evening, everyone. I'm just going to take 5 minutes of your time. I know it's late, but I just wanted to thank the organizers for inviting us. It was a very good event. We enjoyed every workshop, every presentation. It was very engaging. And I'm just going to share with you some of the issues that I've seen working with the Latino community, especially with the Latino community at the Alzheimer's Association. So in most diverse cultures, family is extremely important, as you may know. It's the center of care, the center of support, and the care for elders is provided by the extended family, usually the women in the family, the wife, the daughter-in-law, or the daughter. But at the same time, our elders have the responsibility to take for their grandchildren, because people work, I work, so my mom is taking care of my children. So that's another responsibility that they have. And just imagine for a second, if a grandparent has a diagnosis of dementia or Alzheimer's, imagine what is going to happen if the grandma has to pick up their grandson at school. She might forget, she might get lost. So it changes the dynamic of the family, changes the responsibilities as well. The other thing that we have seen is that these families are unlikely to seek out for services for long-term care options. I'm talking about nursing homes, I'm talking about adult day health or assisted living, because we usually care for our loved ones at home. And we have to respect that, but at the same time, we have to inform people of the options they have out there, the services they have. And caregiving, especially in Hispanic families, is always seen as a payback. I have the responsibility to care for my parents because they love me, they care for me, so I feel that. And so that's why we care our families, our loved ones at home. Just a few healthcare issues that we have. So literacy can affect awareness of the health conditions and use of services. Also limited English that makes it difficult to communicate with health providers. The citizenship, the status, the migratory status can be also challenges because some people, if they don't have Medicare, they can benefit from the services that they provide. Also, the lack of knowledge of available assistance programs and coordination of care and misinformation of long-term planning or no plan at all, because we usually, as Hispanics, we say that we live the present and we don't care too much about the future. But when you have a diagnosis of Alzheimer's, planning is very important, because if I have Alzheimer's, I have to think who's going to care for me, who's going to make the decisions, the legal and financial decisions. So religion, I'm just going to go fast on this one. Religion plays an important role, especially in Hispanic families. We look for coping with the stress, and we look for this emotional support at our churches as well. Here are some perceptions regarding Alzheimer's disease. Especially with the Latino community, Alzheimer's is seen as part of normal aging. We don't see Alzheimer's as a progressive disease, and some people think that it's God's will, and also people with this disease are seen as they lost their mind. And usually it's confused with other type of diseases. People might think that it's atherosclerosis. okay, or other mental illness. Another thing is that family caregivers identify their role as giving love, yes? So caregiving for us is just giving love and provide a nurture environment. And these are the main challenges that we face, is accessing services, navigating the system, because the system here in the United States is completely different. When we talk to people and tell them, you may contact a social worker or the case manager, they don't even know what it is. They don't even know how to contact these people. So we need to educate them about the system, the medical health system here. And we also face financial and legal issues, as I mentioned before. We are not used to plan for the future, but when you have a diagnosis of Alzheimer's, it's very important to plan for the future. So I wanted to end by sharing some information. Kathy also spoke about the helpline, so we have in that table in the back the helpline. I just wanted to add that it works 24 hours and we serve 150 languages, so anyone can call and can be transferred to an interpreter, so everyone can be served, okay? That's very important to know. We also have in the back a brochure showing the Know the 10 Signs. Those are the symptoms of Alzheimer's that I think Kathy mentioned that and the other presenters as well. And this is an event about Advocacy Day, Alzheimer's Advocacy Day. And what is this? It's going to be on Thursday, May 11th at the State House, and we are asking the legislators to pass three bills regarding physicians' education and training, Massachusetts Alzheimer's Project Act, improving elder protective services, and raising Alzheimer's public awareness. So those are the bills that we want to pass to improve the quality of life of people living with Alzheimer's. So I will invite all of you to join us. There is a phone number where you can register or online, and you can find this flyer at the back as well. And that's it for now. So I hope you enjoy the presentation, and thank you for inviting us here. Thank you. Yes, so if you have any questions regarding the disease or any of our programs, please feel free to ask. So let me
I just wanted to put in another plug for Advocacy Day on May 11th, because we've had tremendous successes here in Massachusetts by becoming advocates. One was when we got the Acute Care Act passed. That took years, but it's extremely important. And that means that if you ever have to go into an emergency room or an acute care setting of any kind in the state of Massachusetts or New Hampshire, you now have trained professionals who know how to handle a dementia patient in those settings. Now, this is a tremendous advance from even 10 years ago, because we all know how stressful it is in the ER. It can be cold, it can be bright lights, a lot of noise, people running around, machines making, you know, buzzing sounds and ringing. For a dementia patient, it's extremely stressful. So it's not a good place to be left sitting or laying in a bed for 7 hours. So the Acute Care Act says that these acute care settings will, to the best of their ability, triage those patients so that they can be seen sooner. And that really goes for all elders, because if you're under stress and you're an elderly person, you can have something called emergency room psychosis, right, Alyssa? And that's when you can start, you know, disassociating from reality. That can happen to any one of us at an older age. So advocating is what made this possible. And by showing up, you really advance our agenda to make Massachusetts a dementia-friendly state.